brought to you by Penguin.
Glutton, the multi-course life of a very greedy boy. Written and read by me, Ed Gamble. And make sure you stick around at the end of the audiobook because I have recorded some extra special bonus content with my friend and comedian Nish Kumar, who's mentioned more than he probably should have been in this book. Chapter 1. Starters. My obsession with food is lifelong. The stereotypical image of a child is one of the fussy eater, rejecting most things that are put in front of them, catapulting bowls across the kitchen, and puckering their faces at the merest hint of a new taste. This was not me. The bowls stayed on the high chair, and my face wore a fixed grin, gratefully receiving spoonful after spoonful of whatever new and exciting puree I could lay my chubby little paws on. Most families have a hilarious photo of their child covered in food, the sort of photo that's brought out at gatherings or as a way to embarrass someone in front of a new partner. There exists no such photo of me. Not a drop was wasted from plate to mouth, and the front of my baby grows remained absolutely spotless, although I am reliably informed that the back of my baby grows were a different story. My mum tells me on a regular basis that my mouth was bigger than all the other babies, and easily devoured anything that was wafted in front of it. Come to think about it, I have made the assumption that she was saying my mouth was bigger than all the other babies' mouths. She could have been suggesting that my mouth alone was bigger than other entire babies. While this does sound believable, given the little guzzler I apparently was, I'm sure if it were the case, I would have made the news. There would be a newspaper clipping proudly displayed in a family scrapbook. Baby's mouth the size of other babies. There's no need to open wide for the choo-choo train with this little fella. He could swallow a train with ease, Chris Akabusi would have squawked on Record Breakers. I can tell that baby's mine from the cavernous mouth, the caption on Jeremy Kyle would have read. Anyway, let's not get bogged down in what-ifs. I was a normal-sized baby with a larger-than-average mouth. I was as close to being a foodie as one can be as an infant. If I'd had access to Instagram as a baby, I would have been posting pictures of breast milk to my stories. OMG, such a great meal at Mum's boob. You guys have got to check this place out. There was no food I didn't like. My friends would balk at tomatoes, wince at fish, and turn their noses up at peas. I welcomed it all, eager to stuff my face with all my parents had to offer. Celery was the only thing I refused to eat, and I'm fairly sure that's because I instinctively knew that it was calorie negative. I'm only a recent convert to celery, and only then after I worked out that its shape makes it a perfect vehicle for peanut butter. It's essentially an edible spoon, and hence a cheap way of turning even the laziest home cook into a wild and experimental Heston Blumenthal figure. Prior to the celery discovery, I was simply digging peanut butter out of the jar with my finger. After one too many times hungrily trying to bite through my own flesh, though, I turned to my former enemy. But celery on its own still disgusts me. It tastes simultaneously of nothing and everything, and as such should not be trusted. It's mainly water, I hear you cry. Well, firstly, stop crying. And secondly, if I gave you a glass of water that tasted like celery, you would quite rightly hurl it back into my stupid face. It burns more calories eating it than it has in it. Well, then it's a waste of time. I'd rather just mime eating something, burn my 3 calories, and never have bothered my mouth with that stringy monstrosity. If my parents had a suspicion that they had spawned an eater, this was all but confirmed when the time came to take me to restaurants. Given the choice of what to eat, it was painfully obvious that I wasn't going to toe the line. The kids' menu was swiftly rejected out of hand. I feel safe in saying that I never once chose anything from one of those patronising lists of misery. Even as young as 4, I'd drawn a line in the sand. My mum remembers distinctly taking me for a pub lunch with my grandparents, Nanny and Grandad to me, Steve and Doreen Gamble to you, and Nanny spotted that the pub had a kids' menu. As any right-minded grandma would do, she let me know. I responded, I don't do kids' menus. As a frugal woman who still essentially practiced wartime rationing in her house, I suspected this attitude was quite a shock to Doreen. She took it in her stride, though, no doubt silently worried that my mother had produced a monster and got used to it. Just a couple of years later, while at their house for lunch, I proclaimed that her mashed potatoes were pleasant, but I had heard that Gary Rhodes used double cream in his. The word precocious springs to mind, shortly before the words little and shit. I still don't stand by the concept of kids' menus. Rather than them being needed because children are fussy, I believe that it's the very existence of kids' menus that creates fussy eaters. I'll put my flag in the ground here and now. They should be abolished worldwide. I believe that given half the chance and the right introduction, most kids would happily just eat what adults eat, rather than the sad offerings that are laid in front of them at most restaurants. I hated being talked down to as a child. Why couldn't I have what the adults had? Fish fingers, onion rings, chicken nuggets, chips, potato waffles, all represented to me an injustice at the dinner table. The adults would order whatever they liked, free to roam the expanse of the main menu, while anyone below the age of 10 was forced into a pen of salty sadness. In my mind, adult food was all excitement and colour, while the kids' choices were a homogeneous and unnatural golden hue. As you can see, even I've been brainwashed into using the term golden to describe these fried morsels, when this couldn't be further from the truth. Treasure is golden. Labradors are golden. Fish fingers? Fake tan orange. If treasure or labradors were the same golden that fried food purports to be, you would leave it buried and have it put down respectively. The kids' menu is not a worthwhile culinary endeavour. If it were, restaurants wouldn't have to provide activities with it to distract the child. Don't worry that all the food's the same shade. We'll be providing the colour with this free pack of Crayola. Nothing made me less excited for a meal as a child than the pressure to complete a word search with a crayon that was simultaneously too thick and too fragile for the task. I'm not saying that we should be giving six-year-olds oysters, although I'm sure I would have jumped at the chance to try one. I just think we should give them a little more credit. I'm happy to ease the transition by abolishing menu items one by one. First against the wall, the potato smiley. Never has a happy face been less appropriate. A sad, tasteless lump fixed in a rigor mortis grin, which I always think of less as a potato smiley and more as a potato grimace. The potato's face awkwardly contorted in shock at what has become of it. The smiley face, of course, was later embraced by rave culture and acid house, and although not a drugsman myself, I am led to believe there was a lot more reason for the smile in this instance. Of course, I could be wrong. Maybe most children do enjoy the food on kids' menus, and I was just a weird fat little snob baby. That will be a running theme in this book. The fact that I could be wrong, that is. We considered This Could Be Wrong as a title before speaking to lawyers who told us that legally we couldn't, as the title suggests I might be right some of the time. History has proved that I am wrong almost 90% of the time. This is probably one of those instances. Even as I was writing this diatribe about kids' menus, I floated my hateful theories to my wife. The response went something like this. Loads of people like fish fingers, Ed. Just because you were born a puffed-up little Lord Fauntleroy, it doesn't mean everyone else was. And yes, there is some evidence to suggest that I was not a normal child when it came to food. Or generally, but that's a different audiobook. Exhibit A. At the wedding of one of my dad's friends, a seven-year-old me sensed injustice when I was informed that there was a separate buffet for the children. Ever the noble agitator, I led a rebellion on behalf of the other kids. They were weak and feeble, crushed by the yoke of adult tyranny. They sat there munching on their nuggets, doing their best job of pretending to enjoy them. Some of them, to be fair, were putting on a pretty convincing performance. They were going the whole nine yards, making approving noises, gleefully dipping away into pots of ketchup, some of them even going back for more. These poor, broken fools. Their commitment to the role was such that they even looked at me strangely when I bravely spoke up to the caterers about the culinary discrimination at work. Sure, there was some resistance from our aproned overlords, but no true change is won without a battle. After a short fracas where phrases like allocated meals and why won't you just eat nuggets and I'll have to get the bride were thrown about, and a minor intervention from my father, I'm happy to say that the day was mine. Yes, I lost many things that day. Potential friends, future work for my father, and my temper. But what I gained cannot be overstated. A lovely piece of poached salmon. I recently recounted this tale to my mum, framing it as the first time I tasted poached salmon. We have good chats. She corrected me and told me that that momentous occasion actually occurred when I was 8 months old at a party hosted by her friend from antenatal class. Apparently my eyes lit up. I tucked in, and everyone else was very impressed. I wager that far from being impressed, the other mothers were instead quite perturbed that she had birthed such an odd little gobbler. Meeting me as an infant must have felt like being in The Omen, but rather than my parents producing the spawn of Satan, they had somehow created a pint-sized Jay Rayner. And yes, you're correct. This is the only audiobook you'll ever hear where the opening bit about the author's childhood features two stories based around poached salmon. I'm happy to say that now I embrace all of the golden foods. I seem to have evolved my tastes in an odd way. As a child, I was eager to show that I could play with the adults, desperate to break the onion ring handcuffs of culinary oppression. Later in life, though, I welcome back the comforting tastes of fish fingers, oven chips and chicken nuggets. Not the potato smileys, though. They can still fuck off. As a child, I was always very welcome at my friends' houses. Not by my friends, necessarily, but by their mums. The majority of them were raising your classic bog-standard nuggets children, day after day of cooking the same things for fussy little snotballs who had only ate about four different meals and rejected vegetables out of hand, turning their noses up at anything that was outside their pathetic 10-year-old worldview. So, as you can imagine, a visit from me was like a breath of fresh air. I would appreciatively gobble down anything that was put in front of me, pausing only for breaths, fewer than I probably should have taken, and to wheeze regular thanks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.